Dear students, today we'll be learning about ADH, agonist and antagonist. ADH means antidiuretic hormone. We'll be learning about where it is produced, what is the function, and what are the drugs that is acting as agonist as well as antagonist on this hormone. Antidiuretic hormone is also known as vasopressin. It is a hormone synthesized as a peptide prohormone in neurons in the hypothalamus and mainly by the supraoptic and the paraventricular nucleus, and it is then converted to AVP, that is arginine vasopressin. So it then travels down the axon of the cell, which terminates in the posterior pituitary and is released from the vesicles into the circulation in response to extracellular fluid hypertonicity or hyperosmolality. So AVP has two primary function. First, it increases the amount of solute-free water reabsorbed back into the circulation, and second is AVP constricts the arterioles, which increases the peripheral vascular resistance and thereby increasing the arterial blood pressure. ADH or vasopressin is a polypeptide hormone containing 9 amino acids. So vasopressin is administered either through intravenous device, intramuscular injection or subcutaneous injection. So the duration of action depends on the mode of administration, and it can range from about 30 minutes to 2 hours. It has a half-life of about 18 to 20 minutes, and it's widely distributed throughout the body and remains in the extracellular fluid. So it is degraded mainly by the liver and excreted through the kidneys. An arginine vasopressin for use in septic shock are intended for intravenous use only. Now, what are the functions of antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin? It has mainly two functions. The first one is it increases the amount of solute-free water reabsorbed back into the circulation from the filtrate in the kidney tubules of the nephron. And second is AVP constricts the arterioles, which increases the peripheral vascular resistance and raises arterial blood pressure. So it has mainly two functions. One is retention of water, second is vasopressor action. So a third function is also possible. So some say that AVP may be released directly into the brain from the hypothalamus and play an important role in social behavior, sexual motivation and pair bonding and maternal response to stress. So these are the possible main functions of antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin. The first function, that is retention of water. So the major function of ADH is retention of water by acting on the kidneys. So it increases the facultative reabsorption. Facultative means optional. It increases the optional reabsorption of water from the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting duct in the kidneys. Mode of action on renal tubules. Without ADH, the luminal membranes of the tubular epithelial cells of the collecting ducts are almost impermeable to water. So immediately inside the cell membrane, there are large channels called aquaporins, which are activated when ADH acts. So when ADH acts on the cell, it first combines with the membrane receptors. These are the V2 receptors that activate adenyl cyclase and cause formation of CAMP inside the tubular cell cytoplasm. The CAMP formed causes phosphorylation of elements in the special vesicles, that is aquaporins, and which then causes the aquaporins to insert into apical cell membranes. So this will provide many areas of high water permeability. So all this will occur within a period of 5 to 10 minutes, and in the absence of ADH, the entire process reverses in another 5 to 10 minutes. This process temporarily provides many new pores that allow free diffusion of water from the tubular fluid through the tubular epithelial cells and into the renal interstitial fluid. Now coming to the vasopressor action of ADH. In large amount, ADH shows vasoconstrictor action. Particularly, it causes constriction of the arteries in all parts of the body, and due to vasoconstriction, the blood pressure increases. So ADH acts on the blood vessels through the V1A receptors. However, the amount of ADH required to cause the vasopressor effect is much greater than the amount required to cause the antidiuretic effect. One of the stimuli One of the stimuli that causes intense ADH secretion is decreased blood volume. So, intense ADH secretion occurs when the blood volume decreases by 15 to 25% or more. And the secretory rate then sometimes rises to as high as 50 times the normal. Now, what is the mode of action? So, as you all know, atria has stretch receptors. So these get excited when there is overfilling. So when these stretch receptors get excited, they send signals to the brain to inhibit ADH secretion. Oppositely, when the receptors are not excited as a result of underfilling, the opposite occurs with greatly increased ADH secretion. So decreased stretch of the baroreceptors of the carotid, aortic and the pulmonary regions also stimulate ADH secretion. Regulation of secretion. So ADH secretion depends upon the volume of the body fluid and the osmolarity of the body fluids. The potent stimulants for ADH secretion are decrease in the extracellular fluid volume and increase in the osmolar concentration in the ECF. Now, what are the role of osmoreceptors? So osmoreceptors are receptors situated in the hypothalamus near the supraoptic and the paraventricular nuclei. So when these when the osmolar concentration of blood increases, these osmoreceptors are activated. So when these osmoreceptors are activated, they stimulate the supraoptic and the paraventricular nuclei, which send signals to the posterior pituitary through the nerve fibers and causes release of ADH. So this is how ADH is released. ADH causes reabsorption of water from the renal tubules. So this will increase the ECF volume and restore the normal osmolarity. Now coming to the osmoreceptor ADH feedback system, as the osmolarity increases above normal due to water deficit, the feedback system operates. So when there is an increase in extracellular fluid osmolarity, it causes the special nerve cells called the osmoreceptor cells located in the anterior hypothalamus near the supraoptic nuclei to shrink. This shrinkage of osmoreceptor cells causes them to fire. So what happens after firing? When the osmoreceptors start firing, these signals are taken to the additional nerve cells in the supraoptic nuclei, which then relay these signals down the stalk of the pituitary gland to the posterior pituitary. So these action potentials conducted to the posterior pituitary stimulate the release of ADH, which is stored in the secretory granules or the vesicles in the nerve endings. So the ADH enters the bloodstream and is transported to the kidneys, where it increases the water permeability of the late distal tubules, cortical collecting tubules and the medullary collecting ducts, and thereby water is getting absorbed. This increased water permeability in the distal nephron segments causes an increased water reabsorption and excretion of only a small volume of concentrated urine. Now coming to the vasopressin receptors. So vasopressin act by different vasopressin receptors. There are mainly, broadly they are classified into two receptors, that is V1 receptor and the V2 receptor. Under the V1 receptor, there is again V1A receptor and the V1B or the V3 receptor. Now under the V1A receptor, these are present in the smooth muscles of the blood vessels, smooth muscles of other visceral organs, myometrium, platelets and the liver. Now coming to the V1B or the V3 receptor, they are present in the anterior pituitary, hypothalamic circumventricular organs, pancreas and the adrenal medulla. Now coming to the V2 receptors, there is basically renal receptors and the extrarenal receptors. The renal receptors are present in the epithelial cells of the collecting ducts in the kidney, that is on the luminal side, and extrarenal receptors, they are present in the blood vessels, platelets, vascular endothelium. So these are the different situations of vasopressin receptors. Now coming to the action of ADH in kidney, mainly through the V2 receptors, there are basically three mechanisms. One is increasing CAMP intracellularly, which will result in activation of the protein kinase A, which will result in phosphorylation of proteins, promotes exocytosis of aquaporin 2 in apical membrane, which will increase the water permeability and thereby result in antidiuresis. So it can also stimulate the V2 receptors present in the ascending limb of loop of Henle, activate the sodium potassium chloride co-transporter, which will increase the synthesis and increase the medullary hypertonicity, which will result in antidiuresis. Now there is another mechanism which will activate the vasopressin regulated urea transporter, which will increase the urea permeability of terminal parts of collecting ducts, which will again result in increased medullary hypertonicity, resulting in antidiuresis. So these are the main mechanism of action through the V2 receptors in the kidney. In the kidney, via the V1A receptors, so through the V1A receptors, they will construct the vasorecta, decrease the blood flow, increase osmolality and thereby cause antidiuresis. ADH also increase production of prostaglandins from interstitial cells, decrease responsiveness of CD cells to V2 receptor stimulation, and it can even lead to diuresis. So these are the two functions through the V1A receptor. Other actions. In the blood vessel, there are mainly V1A receptor and the V2 receptors. The main action is vasoconstriction and vasodilatation. In the gastrointestinal system, there is V1A receptor, which will increase the peristalsis of the large bowel, thereby causes expulsion of the gases. In the uterus, there is the V1A receptor, which can cause contraction of the uterus. In the non-pregnant uterus, AVP and oxytocin have similar sensitivity. At term, oxytocin selectivity increases. In the liver, there is the V2 receptors, which will increase the glycogenolysis. In the platelets, there is a V2 receptor, which will increases the aggregation and releases coagulation factors 8 and von Willebrand factor. In the central nervous system, there is a V1B or the V3 receptor, which will act as a neurotransmitter, neuromodulator. In V1A receptor, in the cerebral vessel construction. So it will maintain the temperature, circulation, ACTH release and learning of task. In the cardiovascular system, V1A receptor constricts the coronary blood vessels. There will be an initial tachycardia and hypotension, and finally there will be bradycardia. The pharmacokinetics, it is an orally inactive and it is metabolized mainly by trypsin. Vasopressin, when given subcutaneously or intramuscularly, remains in body for a few hours, and when it is given IV, it is rapidly metabolized by liver and some in the kidney. However, the plasma t-half is about 20 minutes. What are the different vasopressin antagonist and agonist? Vasopressin antagonist are conivaptan, tolvaptan, lixivaptan, lorelcovaptan, cetavaptan, mosavaptan, and SSR149415. Now agonists are feliprasin, liprasin, desmopressin and telipressin. So these are the various agonist and antagonist. Now coming to the first agonist, that is desmopressin, also known as DDAVP, that is D-amino-8-D-arginine vasopressin. It acts via the V2 receptors and acts mainly on the aquaporin channels. So when these aquaporin channels get activated, it will increase the water reabsorption from the urine. So it also stimulates the release of von Willebrand factor by acting on the V2 receptors. Now it is degraded more slowly than recombinant vasopressin, and its less frequent administration is required. Now it also has less effect on BP, while vasopressin causes arterial hypertension. Now coming to the structure activity relationship, there is substitution with D-arginine, which will reduce the pressor activity, and when there is removal of terminal amino acid, it will increase the half-life, that is about 13 to 22 hours. The formulations available are oral, sublingual, parenteral and intranasal. Now coming to the uses, it is mainly used in diabetes insipidus, diagnostic test, that is differentiate between neurogenic and nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, and nocturnal aneurysms, bedwetting in children. So it can be used as a treatment for nighttime bedwetting in children, and renal concentration test, which is a test used to know how well your kidneys are acting in response to too much or too little fluid. So it can also be used in case of bleeding disorders, that is hemophilia and von Willebrand disease. Other agonists are vasopressin, liprasin, Feliprasin, terlipresin and gliprasin. So liprasin is a 8 lysine vasopressin. Even though somewhat less potent than vasopressin, it acts on both V1 and the V2 receptors and has longer duration of action. That is around 4 to 6 hours. So it is being used in place of AVP and mostly for V1 receptor mediated action. So the dose is 20 international units per ml injections. Now coming to terlipressin. Terlipressin is a synthetic prodrug of vasopressin and is specifically used for bleeding esophageal varices and appears to produce less severe adverse effects than liprasin. It is also longer acting than vasopressin. The dose is 2 mg IV. So coming to gliprasin. Gliprasin is a triglyceride lysine vasopressin. It releases the hormone very slowly in the body. That is about, it will take about 10 hours. Coming to conivaptan. Conivaptan is a non-selective V1 V2 receptor blocker. Only IV formulations are available. It is a CYP3A4 inducer. So there will be lot of drug interactions. So because of these drug interactions, so any drug which is metabolized with this enzyme should be monitored. And continuous electrolyte monitoring is a must. Those patients who are hospitalized and are receiving conivaptan, their serum magnesium, potassium, sodium should be monitored. Now uses are euvolemic or hypervolemic hyponatremia in case of heart failure, that is trials are ongoing. So side effects include headache, thirst, dry mouth, hypokalemia, orthostatic hypotension. So when used in liver cirrhosis, chances of variceal bleeding is there. Mechanism of action of vaptans. Vaptans produce aquaresis. So what is aquaresis? Aquaresis means excretion of solute free urine. So they differ from diuretics as they promote excretion of water without the loss of electrolytes and are hence characterized as aquaretics. Now vaptans act on vasopressin type 2 receptors in the collecting duct and thus increase solute free water excretion. Vaptans are being used as an alternative to fluid restriction in euvolemic and hypovolemic hyponatremic patients. Efficacy of vaptans is now well accepted for management of correction of hyponatremia over a short period. Now coming to tolvaptan. Tolvaptan is an orally active non-peptide selective V2 receptor blocker that has been recently introduced for treatment of hyponatremia due to congestive heart failure, cirrhosis of liver or syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. It increases the free water clearance by the kidney and helps to correct hyponatremia. So in clinical trials, it has shown that it will improve heart failure. But you should never attempt overcorrection of hyponatremia immediately because it can lead to thrombotic complications due to hemoconcentration. So the most frequent side effect is thirst and dry mouth. Others are fever, gastrointestinal upset and hyperglycemia. Tolvaptan is metabolized mainly by CYP3A4 and it should not be given to patients receiving inhibitors of this enzyme. So the plasma half-life is about 6 to 8 hours and is given once a day. So there is another drug called mosavaptan. Mosavaptan is also a V2 selective blocker. Now coming to lixivaptan. Lixivaptan is a selective V2 receptor blocker and it is given orally. Relcovaptan. Relcovaptan is a V1A selective antagonist used in case of Raynaud's disease, dysmenorrhea and as a tocolytic. Now nelvivaptan. Nelvivaptan is a V1B selective drug. Used in case of psychiatric disorders. Now coming to pharmacotherapy of diabetes insipidus. So diabetes insipidus is a rare disorder where large volume of urine, that is hypotonic, dilute and tasteless, is produced. So patient, there can be either primary polydipsia, central diabetes insipidus, nephrogenic diabetes insipidus and diabetes insipidus of pregnancy. Now let us see the pharmacotherapy of each. Primary polydipsia. The reasons can be drugs that cause dry mouth, peripheral disorders increasing, RAS, psychiatric syndromes and habitual polydipsia. Treatment is mainly by propranolol, which inhibits the RAS. Central diabetes insipidus, the main cause is genetic, can be also due to malignancy, sarcoidosis, infection, surgery, trauma. Treatment is first is water, giving water, and second is water retaining agents like desmopressin, L-arginine vasopressin, clopropamide, clofibrate, carbamazepin and indomethacin. So natriuretic peptides can also be tried like thiazide diuretics, amyloid, indapamide. So all these are the treatment options of central diabetes insipidus. Other treatment of central diabetes insipidus. So one is desmopressin. Dose is individualized according to 24-hour urine volume. 0.2 milligram orally or 20 microgram intranasal 2 to 3 times per day. Clopropamide increases the hydroosmotic action of residual vasopressin. 250 to 500 milligram per day. It's an off-label use and side effect include hypoglycemia. Now coming to NSAIDs, prolongs the time the water channel remain in the membrane, thus augmenting ADH action. It's an add-on drug with desmopressin. So these are the treatments for central diabetes insipidus. Now let us see what is nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Just now we saw the treatment of central diabetes insipidus. Now let us see what is nephrogenic diabetes insipidus and its treatment. So what is the cause of nephrogenic diabetes insipidus? So it is basically a genetic mutation in the V2 receptors which results in collecting duct are completely or partially insensitive to ADH. It can be also due to drugs. So drugs like lithium. Lithium is a drug that is taken for bipolar disorder. Up to 20% of the people taking lithium will develop nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. So there are other drugs which can cause diabetes insipidus like dimethylcycline, ofloxacin, orlistat. So all these are the common drugs which can cause nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Now what is the treatment of nephrogenic diabetes insipidus? If it is due to a drug, you should stop the offending drug as soon as possible. You should increase the water intake. And you can also give thiazide diuretic. So the thiazide diuretics in nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, we call it as paradoxical antidiuretic action. So the proposed mechanism is that thiazides induce a state of sustained electrolyte depletion. So because of the sustained electrolyte depletion, it will stimulate the sodium and water reabsorption from the proximal convoluted tubule. So the urine presented to distal tubule has less filtrate, it passes as such excreted. So this is the proposed mechanism of treatment with thiazide diuretics. There is one another mechanism in case of thiazides, in case of nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. They can inhibit the enzyme cyclonucleotide phosphodiesterase, thus increasing the 3-5 cyclic AMP levels, thus increase membrane permeability of collecting duct to water. So the dose is 100 milligram per day per oral, and potassium supplementation has to be given. What are the other treatments of nephrogenic diabetes insipidus? So if it is a drug-induced nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, and if it is due to lithium, amyloid is the drug of choice. Now, vaptans can also be used. Vaptans are in rescuing the mutant receptors, and they act as pharmacological chaperones. So, a pharmacological chaperone, a pharmacoperone, is a drug that acts as a protein chaperone. So, what does it mean? It means that it will contain small molecules that enter the cells and serve as a molecular scaffolding, so that the normally misfolded proteins will fold and root correctly within the cell. So in case of vaptans, they combine with the misfolded proteins and change the conformation to allow complete maturation of the V2 receptors, which can then be activated by AVP. Non-peptide V2 receptor agonist in case of partially mutated receptors, and they combine with the mutant receptor trapped in the endoplasmic reticulum and allow maturation. So these are the treatment for nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Now let us see diabetes insipidus in pregnancy. So during pregnancy, there is an increased metabolism of vasopressin due to cysteine aminopeptidase, which is also known as oxytocinase or vasopressinase, which is an enzyme that normally degrades oxytocin and prevents premature uterine contraction. Now the treatment of diabetes insipidus in pregnancy is desmopressin, which is the only recommended drug. 25% oxytocin activity of AVP, and it's not metabolized by oxytocinase. So these are the benefits of. After delivery, generally recurs spontaneously. Now let us see the pharmacotherapy of SIAD. Syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion is a clinical condition where ADH is secreted in excess than physiological limit. So what are the causes of SIAD? It can be due to tumors or central nervous system lesions, paraneoplasia, or drugs. So the drugs implicated in SIAD are antipsychotics, anticonvulsants, cytotoxic agents, and even pain medications. These are the drugs that usually can cause SIAD. So diagnosis is by Barter and Schwartz clinical criteria. Treatment is fluid restriction, that is 500 ml to 1 liter. Dimethylcycline, that is tetracycline antibiotic, which inhibits the adenylate cyclase, thus decreasing the CAMP. Other management of syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. One is saline infusion. 3% NaCl is infused for acute hyponatremia with severe neurological deficits. The offending drug or offending agent should be stopped, and we can also use Vaptans, that is vasopressin antagonist. Chronic CRT directly block the receptor-mediated action of vasopressin. Conivaptan and tolvaptan, these are two drugs which can be given. Conivaptan 20 mg loading dose over 30 minutes, 20 to 40 mg per day continuous infusion, that is for 4 days. Tolvaptan starting dose is 15 mg first day and 30 mg and 60 mg on 3rd day, 4th day, titrated according to the osmolality or the sodium levels. Oral urea can also be used, that will correct the osmolality by increasing the solute-free water excretion. Can be used in case of chronic CRT. Disadvantage is that poorly palatable, and because of that patient compliance will be less. Preferred in SAH and critical care. Now coming to desmopressin, in severe CRT along with saline infusion to avoid rapid and overcorrection, which can result in osmotic demyelination. Furosemide with sodium chloride still needs validation. So that's all about this topic, that is ADH agonist and antagonist. Please go through the slides and prepare for an assignment which will be coming in few days. Thank you.